Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Bite Club by Laurien Berenson. Narrated by Angie Hickman. Chapter 1. It started as a joke. After all, who would name a friendly book club Bite Club? Well, we did. First, because we were all dog lovers, some of whom had met as fellow dog show exhibitors. And second, because when we formed the group, we decided to concentrate on reading mystery novels, books with bite. Plus, we all kind of liked the idea of belonging to a club that sounded as though Brad Pitt might stop by on occasion. Especially Terry D'Annunzio. Terry always has plenty to say, and all of it entertaining. He didn't back down when the rest of us told him that he was barking up the wrong tree because Brad Pitt wasn't gay. Instead, Terry just sat there and smiled, like he knew something we didn't. It wouldn't be the first time. Terry is one of my best friends, and I've seen him in action. I'm pretty sure if anyone could change Pitt's preferred orientation, Terry would be the one to do it. You might be wondering what all that had to do with books. Truthfully, not much. We weren't even halfway through our first meeting when it occurred to me that maybe the books were just a good excuse for us to get together and enjoy each other's company. And drink a little wine while we were at it. The idea for the book club had arisen from my own love of reading. I'd envisioned spending a few evenings a month with a small group of like-minded people. Good friends coming together to share stories and swap reading recommendations. I'd begun by recruiting my former neighbor, Alice Brickman. She and I had met years earlier, when our older children were infants. The shared trials and tribulations of motherhood had brought us together, then quickly solidified our bond. Since I'd remarried and moved to a different part of town, Alice and I didn't see nearly as much of each other as we used to. This seemed like a wonderful opportunity to reconnect. Next, I'd called Claire Walden Travis, a family member by virtue of being married to my ex-husband, which also made her stepmother to my older son, Davy. She'd been delighted to become part of the group. An organizer by nature and profession, she'd brought a list of potential book choices to the first meeting to get us started. Then I'd asked Terry to join us. He's the longtime partner of professional dog handler Crawford Langley. He's also the best-looking man I've ever met. I'd like to be able to tell you that Terry's flashy exterior conceals hidden depths, but not really. With Terry, what you see is what you get. He's exuberant in his love for dogs, for his friends, and for cozy mysteries. In other words, he was a perfect addition to the club. It was about that time that my Aunt Peg found out about my plans, and overnight my little reading group suddenly became a big deal. That tended to happen whenever Margaret Turnbull got involved with anything. For decades, she'd been one of the country's premier breeders of standard poodles. Now she was a much-in-demand dog show judge. Aunt Peg was accustomed to having her opinions matter. She also had a habit of bossing people around, especially her relatives. Most especially, me. Is it any wonder that she hadn't been among the first people I'd called? Apparently, that made no difference. Aunt Peg simply assumed that she would be included, and unfortunately, none of us were brave enough to dispute that assumption. True to form, Aunt Peg first wanted to iron out a few details.
"Why are you forming a book club?"
she wanted to know.
"Aren't you busy enough already?"
"Well, sure, but I always make time to read." Aunt Peg looked dubious. She was already approved to judge the non-sporting and toy groups. Her idea of reading for entertainment probably meant perusing the breed standards of new dog breeds she planned to add to her repertoire. Either that or the Encyclopedia Britannica.
"Books?"
she asked. "Of course books. Mostly mystery novels." Aunt Peg blinked twice and remained mute. That was a first. Over the years, she and I have been involved in the solving of more than a few mysteries ourselves. Surely, my choice of reading material made perfect sense. Aunt Peg still didn't look convinced by the wisdom of my idea. Or maybe she just wanted to continue arguing. There's nothing she enjoys more than a good verbal sparring match. I'm pretty sure she thinks vocal confrontation should be a national pastime, like baseball games and eating junk food. As for me, I wasn't even sure why we were having this conversation. After all, no one, least of all me, had invited her to join the book club. Nevertheless, I felt the need to justify my decision. Yet again. For some reason, Aunt Peg always had that effect on me. Well, on everybody, really. We all did our best to shape up when Aunt Peg was around. Being related to her was like living with my own personal cyclone, or maybe a runaway train. Reading is fun, I told her. It's educational. It reduces stress.
Of course it's fun. I do it all the time. You're not the only one who enjoys a good mystery novel.
Then she thought about what I'd said and stopped.
Stress? Why on earth would you feel stressed?
Plenty of reasons. And I probably didn't have to point out that the first one was standing right in front of me, trying to hijack my book club idea and turn it into something she liked better. But beyond that, I lead a busy life. I'm a wife, a mother of two wonderful sons, and a special needs tutor at a private school. I also have a house full of standard poodles, 5 to be exact, plus a small spotted mutt named Bud. Sometimes I wondered if there would be enough hours in the day to get everything done. Then I stopped wondering and started doing. Every mother knows how that works. I narrowed my eyes at Aunt Peg. It was difficult to produce a full long glare, since I'm 5.5 feet tall and the person I wanted to intimidate towered over me by more than 6 inches. Aunt Peg was nearing 70. She had the posture of a ballerina and shoulders that would do a linebacker proud. It was a formidable combination. Do you want to join or not? I asked.
I'm considering.
I sighed under my breath. Considering what, exactly?
Whether or not I want to let other people dictate my choice of reading material.
You're right, I agreed, probably too quickly. That sounds like a terrible idea. Aunt Peg wasn't fooled by my easy acquiescence.
You're trying to get rid of me?
Not at all. I'm simply enabling you to make the responsible choice.
I'd be delighted to join your little group,
she decided abruptly.
Can we hold the meetings at my house?
And already she wanted to be in charge. You can hold some of them at your house, I said. Everyone will take turns hosting. We'll meet twice a month, every other Tuesday night. Aunt Peg nodded. I was pretty sure she'd stopped listening to me.
I might have some other ideas for new members.
And that was when things began to spiral beyond my control. 6 people had attended the first meeting held at my house. 7 had shown up at Alice's home 2 weeks later. Now it was the night of our 3rd meeting, scheduled to take place at Aunt Peg's. Judging by the glee with which she'd volunteered to serve as hostess, I suspected she might be planning a crowd. Not for the first time when it came to my dealings with Aunt Peg, I wondered what I'd gotten myself into. Aunt Peg lives in the backcountry area of Greenwich, Connecticut. Her house has clapboard siding and a wraparound porch, and once served as the family home for a working farm. 40 years earlier, Aunt Peg and her husband Max, then newly married, had purchased the property to found their Cedar Crest Kennel. Over the ensuing decades, it had been home to dozens of champion standard poodles. My car window was open to admit the warm, early July breeze when I turned into Aunt Peg's driveway. Max had been deceased for a decade now, and the kennel building behind the house had burned to the ground the previous summer. For a moment, I imagined that the scent of that long-gone smoke still lingered in the air. Glancing in that direction, I squinted toward the descending sun and saw nothing but a wide stretch of uninterrupted lawn where the building had once stood. Of course, the thought had been fanciful. I quickly dismissed it and parked the Volvo toward the rear of the empty driveway. The meeting was scheduled to start at 7. 15 minutes early, I was obviously the first to arrive. Visitors to Aunt Peg's house were met with an effusive canine greeting, offered in the belief that if you minded being mobbed by her standard poodles, she probably didn't want to know you anyway. By now, I was accustomed to the onslaught. Her dogs and I were old friends. Not only that, but each of them was related to the poodles I had at home. The four adults were the first to come flying down the front steps to say hello. All were black in color, and all were Finnish champions. They sported the easy-to-maintain kennel clip, with their faces, feet, and the base of their tails clipped short, and a trim blanket of curls covering the remainder of their bodies. The two bitches, Hope and Willow, led the way. The males, Zeke and Beau, brought up the rear. Coral, the only puppy in the group, remained standing in the doorway at Aunt Peg's side. Coral was 9 months old and just starting her career in the show ring. She already had 2 points toward her championship, and my teenage son, Davy, was going to be handling her in some summer shows. Coral's dense black coat was longer than that of the other poodles. It was carefully shaped to leave a profusion of hair on the back of her neck and over her shoulders. The puppy's topknot was banded into ponytails on top of her head, and her ear hair was wrapped in brightly colored plastic paper. Until Coral won the coveted 15 points needed to attain her championship, her coat, which had been growing from birth, would need to be cosseted and protected at all times. For that reason, she usually wasn't allowed to join in the older poodle's rough and tumble play. Now, however, Aunt Peg released the big black puppy from her side, and Coral came skipping down the steps joyously. When I knelt down, she threw herself into my arms.
"You're early."
Aunt Peg followed her canine crew down the stairs.
"Don't think I'm going to let you dive into the pupcakes before everyone else arrives."
"Me?" I managed an innocent look. Okay, so maybe I'd skimped on dinner in anticipation of the goodies I was sure to find at Aunt Peg's gathering. Her sweet tooth was legendary. And over the years I'd spent in her company, I'd developed my own lust for sweets by osmosis. I knew there would be pastries from the St. Moritz bakery waiting inside. Pupcakes, vanilla cupcakes whimsically frosted to resemble a puppy's face, were a special treat.
"Yes, you,"
Aunt Peg replied sternly.
"I'm expecting a full house tonight. I would hate to run out of refreshments."
"A full house?" I tried not to sound annoyed. "How did that happen?" Aunt Peg snapped her fingers. The poodles immediately stopped racing around the front yard. They ran up the steps and through the open door into the house. She and I followed.
"Oh, you know,"
Aunt Peg said blithely.
"One thing led to another."
"You do realize this was supposed to be a small group, right? Just some friends getting together to talk about books."
"Yes, of course. But there's the problem. I have so many friends."
Aunt Peg ushered me in the direction of her living room. The two chintz-covered love seats that had flanked the fireplace were now angled to face a grouping of assorted chairs gathered from the dining room and library. At a quick glance, I counted more than a dozen seats. The refreshments were set out on a sideboard. There was a pot of tea and several bottles of wine, along with appropriate china and stemware. A tray of pupcakes was sitting beside a large dish of chocolate and macaroon Sarah Bernhardt's. The entire display looked heavenly.
"Like, how many?" I asked.
I sidled over toward the buffet and reached for a Sarah Bernhardt. Aunt Peg slapped my hand away.
"Wait for the guests to arrive," she said.
"I'm a guest."
"Since when?"
There was that.
I turned away and sat down on the edge of a love seat. Hope walked over and placed her head in my lap. I ruffled my fingers through her topknot and ears. Hope was a littermate to my beloved Faith. I was sure she could smell her sister's scent on my clothing.
"How many?" I repeated.
"They're a lively cross-section of exhibitors. You probably know some of them, or at least you've seen them at shows. I'm sure you'll like them once you've met them."
Note that once again, she dodged my question.
Do they read books? I asked.
I should hope so. I did tell them this was a book club.
I suppose that counted for something. Do they have names?
Oh, pish, said Aunt Peg. Of course they have names. Felicity Barber, for one.
I frowned briefly. After a moment, a vague image of the woman's face swam into view. I was pretty sure she had a toy breed. We're dog people. We identify everyone by their breed affiliation. Japanese chin? I guessed.
That's right.
Aunt Peg looked pleased. Apparently, I turned out to be a better student than expected.
Marge Brennan,
she said next. I know her. She has bulldogs. Marge was a fellow non-sporting group exhibitor. She was easy to picture. Short and squat, she also had the pendulous cheeks and perpetual scowl of her chosen breed. Who else?
Jeff Schwinn.
I shook my head.
Tall, skinny, greyhounds, you know.
No, I don't. And just like that, my approval rating dipped again. Aunt Peg rushed through the rest.
Toby Kane, he has Welshies.
Welsh Springer Spaniels for the uninitiated.
And Rush and Vic Landry breed Belgian Tervurens. There, you see, that's all.
That's six new people, I pointed out unnecessarily. Alice had arrived at our first book club meeting with a neighbor named Evan Major, who'd recently moved onto her block. She'd confided that she'd brought him along because she felt sorry for him. A small, unassuming man in his 40s, Evan had been shy in our boisterous company and had mostly kept his thoughts to himself. He didn't volunteer any personal information, but he did describe himself as an avid reader. At our second meeting, held at Alice's house, another neighbor had shown up unexpectedly. Bella Burundi came through the door with a smile on her face and a pot full of homemade macaroni and cheese in her hands. She informed us that Evan had invited her to join the group, though he appeared surprised to hear that. But Bella had read the book we were discussing, and she joined our conversation with enthusiasm. So we accepted her into the fold. At the time, I thought that seven people seemed like a fine size for the book club. It was large enough to offer room for differing opinions, yet small enough to keep things cozy and copacetic. And now it seemed that our numbers had nearly doubled. Thank you, Aunt Peg, I thought somewhat murderously.
You're welcome, she replied.
Oh, Lord. I hadn't said that out loud, had I? The doorbell rang, and Aunt Peg went to answer it. The standard poodles leapt up and ran after her, the five of them eddying around the closely grouped furniture like a fast-flowing canine stream. A moment later, a chorus of new voices filled the front hall. Ready or not, I thought, here we go. Chapter 2.
Where did all these people come from? Asked Terry.
Only minutes had passed, but the living room was already packed with a lively crowd. I'd given up my perch on the love seat to claim a spot by the wall from which to observe the new arrivals. Fortunately, the corner I'd staked out was next to the dish of Sarah Bernhardt's. When Terry cut through the group and joined me there, I just stuffed a second one into my mouth. Since I was briefly unable to speak, Terry took up the slack.
This crowd is unexpected, isn't it? I'm glad I dressed for the occasion.
He peered around the room.
Is that Rush Landry? I wouldn't have pictured him as a novel reader. Automotive magazines, maybe, or possibly porn.
I swallowed hastily and slapped him on the arm. Stop that!
Stop what? Saying out loud what you know perfectly well you're thinking?
I am not, I replied. And what is that you're wearing anyway? Terry was in his 30s, but he could easily pass for a decade younger. For some reason, he'd decided to come to the meeting dressed in a velvet smoking jacket with a cream-colored cravat knotted around his neck. His blonde hair was slicked back off his face, and his nails were perfectly manicured. He looked like an extra in a British period film. All he needed to complete the picture was a pipe and a valet.
Do you like it?
Terry spun in place. Though it was evening, the temperature hovered around 80 degrees. Dressed like that, I would have been sweltering. Terry looked cool as a cucumber. Or maybe a cucumber sandwich.
I found the ensemble online. It seemed like just the thing to wear to this convivial gathering.
If we were on Downton Abbey, maybe, I retorted. In February.
It may not be high clear, but we are at Aunt Peg's house. For all I knew, the dress code might be formal.
We're here for a book club meeting, I told him. My book club. It's casual. You wore shorts to my house last month.
You held your shindig in the backyard. Shorts were appropriate.
At my house, we'd sat out back on the deck and sipped sangria. We'd held our discussion with the poodles and Bud cavorting in the yard around us. At least that part was the same, I thought, as Claire Travis stepped through the doorway and gave Zeke a friendly pat on the head. Aunt Peg's poodles were mingling happily with the guests.
Last time there were just half a dozen of us, Terry said. You know, a friendly gathering. Tonight, this place is jammed. What happened?
I'm surprised you even have to ask. I nodded toward the hallway where my aunt was holding court. Aunt Peg happened.
Did she invite the entire dog show world?
I sincerely hope not, but don't hold me to it.
Who's that?
Terry pointed toward a tall man with black-framed glasses and a long, slender nose.
He looks familiar, but I can't quite place him.
Aunt Peg acquainted me with the guest list before you got here. I'm guessing that's Jeff Schwinn. She said he has greyhounds.
Of course, Terry said with a nod.
When you've been to as many dog shows as we have, the entire dog community begins to look like someone you probably know. Alice entered the room, spotted me, and immediately waved. She cut through the throng of people between us and made her way to my side. Alice's husband Joe was a partner at a law firm in Greenwich. Her son Joey was 13 like Davy, and the two of them were best friends. Daughter Carly, a budding ballerina, was 3 years younger. Alice worked part-time as a paralegal at Joe's firm. We both missed the easy intimacy we'd enjoyed when we were young moms and neighbors. Sharing babysitters and swapping kid-friendly recipes, we'd supported each other through highs and lows. No matter what transpired, Alice would always have my back, just as I had hers. She and I shared a quick hug. Terry poured her a glass of Pinot Grigio. Both part of the original book club, they'd known each other for almost a month.
What's with the crowd? Alice asked.
She gulped down a swallow of wine as if to fortify herself.
Did I come on the wrong night?
Claire was heading our way too. She arrived just in time to hear Alice's question.
Ditto that for me, she said.
Claire was sleek as a cat. She had shiny, dark hair and honey-toned skin. An event planner by trade, she was very good at managing things and people. Now her hand lifted, long fingers pointed gracefully toward the sideboard.
And ditto on the wine too, Terry, if you wouldn't mind.
Not at all, he replied. In fact, I'll pour for all four of us before the horde descends on this spread like locusts.
Horde indeed.
Claire caught my eye and frowned.
This is Peg's doing, isn't it? I should have known our amiable little group was too good to last.
Claire was a relative newcomer to the family. She and Bob had been married for just 18 months. Unlike most people, Claire wasn't intimidated by Aunt Peg. Of course, when they'd first met, Claire had suspected that Peg might be guilty of murder. The two women were friends now, but Claire had no illusions about the kind of mischief Aunt Peg was capable of causing.
You know Aunt Peg, I told her. The bigger the production, the better.
I'm not surprised she wanted to add to the group, but what I can't figure out is how she managed to dig up so many book lovers among the dog show crowd so quickly. It's not as if anyone stands around at the shows and talks about what they're reading.
What makes you think they're all book lovers?
Alice asked skeptically. We all looked around the room. People were gathered in small groups, chatting with one another. Most seemed to be discussing the previous weekend's dog show results. Two were comparing pictures on their phones. No one was holding a book.
Well, for one thing, they're here.
I might have sounded a little defensive.
And for another, Aunt Peg says they are.
Oh, please, Terry sniffed. Peg is the sneakiest woman I've ever met. Since when have you believed everything she told you?
He had a point. Terry lifted his wine glass to point toward a plump, middle-aged woman on the other side of the living room. She had beautifully styled blonde hair and an Hermes scarf wrapped around her throat. Unlike everyone else, she wasn't talking to anyone. Instead, she was standing by herself, surveying the other book club participants with a calculating expression on her face.
That's Felicity Barber, he told us. She's been showing dogs since Crawford was in short pants, and she's one of the toughest competitors on the circuit. Felicity would sell her own mother to get in the good graces of a judge as powerful as Peg.
I huffed out a breath. Well, that's disappointing. Claire didn't think so. She seemed to be enjoying herself.
$5 says Felicity didn't read this week's book.
$10 says she doesn't even know the title, Alice shot right back.
Done, said Claire. The two women shook on it. I winced and looked away.
Some people had put in an appearance tonight to gain favor. Others were placing bets. My friendly little book club was morphing into something unrecognizable right before my eyes, and I was powerless to prevent it. I chugged the glass of Pinot Terry had handed me and poured myself another. He glanced at me and smothered a grin. Terry doesn't miss a thing. I suspected it was going to be a long night. Aunt Peg stepped into the middle of the room. As hostess for the meeting, it was her job to take charge to the proceedings.
Can I have everyone's attention, please?
Conversation died down. People put their phones away. We all turned politely in her direction.
I'd like to welcome all of you to tonight's gathering. Bite Club, she said with a smile. Please don't take the name literally.
Most people laughed in appreciation. Marge Brennan, seated on a love seat, emitted a loud guffaw. Apparently, Felicity Barber wasn't the only one who joined the book club in order to suck up to Aunt Peg.
Thank you.
Aunt Peg dipped her head in gracious acknowledgement.
There are refreshments on the sideboard. I hope you will all help yourselves to a drink or a snack. Then please take a seat so we can call the meeting to order. Has anyone counted noses? Is everybody here and ready to get started?
People were making their way toward our side of the room. Drinks already in hand, Alice, Claire, Terry, and I moved out of their way. I was considering the best place to find a seat when Alice spoke up.
I don't see Evan, she said. I know he was planning to be here tonight. I'm sure he must be on his way.
Aunt Peg was a stickler for punctuality. She made a show of looking at her watch, a clear warning to anyone who might contemplate tardiness in the future.
I suppose we can wait a little longer before beginning.
10 minutes later, Evan still hadn't arrived. The selection on the sideboard had been depleted. Dog-related conversation had resumed. And Aunt Peg was growing increasingly restless. She hated it when things didn't go to plan. I was about to ask Alice to give Evan a call when the standard poodles jumped up and ran to the front door.
It's about time,
Aunt Peg muttered under her breath. She followed the dogs out of the room.
I'm so sorry to be late.
Evan's apology was audible from the front hall. A moment later, he appeared in the doorway.
I hope I haven't inconvenienced everyone.
Aunt Peg was right behind him.
As long as you don't make a habit of it.
Her voice trailed away as Evan stepped into the light.
My word, that looks awful. What happened to you?
Evan Major was slight of build and diffident in demeanor. With his pale eyes, receding hairline, and slightly hunched shoulders, he'd struck me as a person who never wanted to stand out in a crowd. Now he had no choice. Everyone in the room was staring at him. Specifically, we were all staring at the bruise, swollen, red, and starting to turn purple, that was blooming on the side of his jaw. Evan's hand rose self-consciously to his face. Oh, this. At 6 feet tall, Aunt Peg towered over him. She leaned in for a closer look.
Yes, that. It appears you must have taken quite a wallop. Would you like me to fetch you an ice pack?
No, thank you. I'm fine, really. Evan started to shake his head, then evidently thought better of it. Please don't go to any trouble on my behalf. It's bad enough that I've delayed the meeting.
Bella Burundi stepped forward. She guided Evan to a nearby chair. None of us minded waiting, and it looks as though you had a very good excuse.
A rumble of assent came from others in the room. It was followed by a weighty silence. Mystery readers are curious people. It was clear that everyone was waiting for Evan to explain himself. He looked pained by the necessity, but finally mumbled,
I got in a car accident on the way here.
You poor thing. Bella patted his back solicitously. Claire gathered a handful of ice from the bucket on the sideboard. She wrapped it in a linen napkin, then crossed the room and handed it to Evan.
This will help the swelling, she said briskly, and take ibuprofen for the pain. Are you injured anywhere else?
No. At least I don't think so.
Evan shrank down into his chair.
It was just a fender bender. I rolled through a stop sign and hit a guy's bumper. Nothing to get excited about. You might think that now.
A man separated himself from the crowd. He had a muscular physique, strong features, and a piercing gaze.
But then lawyers get involved and everything goes south. It sounds like you were the one at fault. No, I...
Evan glanced up uncertainly.
I'm sorry. Who are you? Rush Landry, new book club member.
He grabbed Evan's hand and pumped it up and down.
Just trying to help.
Thank you. Evan managed a small smile.
I appreciate your concern.
He looked at the rest of us.
That goes for all of you. You're very kind to worry about me, but it was nothing. Please, let's just go on with the meeting.
If you're sure,
said Aunt Peg. Evan nodded.
The other driver and I exchanged information. Our insurance companies will take care of everything. I'd really rather just put the whole episode behind me. So on a totally different subject, did anyone happen to read a good book this week?
Aunt Peg knew how to take a cue.
Good question, she agreed. Let's all take our seats, shall we? Margaret Maron is a wonderful writer. I know we'll all have plenty to say about Bootlegger's Daughter. And I'll begin by saying that I think the title is genius. Who wouldn't want to know more about Deborah Knott after a tease like that?
The conversation that followed was fast and furious. People chimed in with opinions from all corners of the room. When they were too impatient to wait their turns, they simply talked over one another. Aunt Peg tried to moderate the discussion, but the choice of the debut novel in Marin's Southern Mystery series had proven so popular that even she could barely get a word in. Those among us who hadn't previously been acquainted with Judge Knott were now planning to dive in and read the rest of the series. Those for whom the book wasn't new had been happy to revisit it. The only complaint came from Toby Kane, who grumbled about the choice of a book that was first published in the previous century. He was quickly overruled by consensus. As for Felicity Barber, she had not only read the assigned book, she gave it a rave review, causing both Alice and Claire to lose their bets. Neither woman seemed to mind.
When the meeting ended, they left arm in arm, still arguing companionably over who had placed the better wager. As the exodus began, I bid adieu to Aunt Peg's standard poodles, who acknowledged my good manners with bright eyes and wagging tails. The line to pay my respects to Aunt Peg was considerably longer. I decided to slip out the door, but before I could make my escape, I was hailed by Evan. He was standing at the sideboard, replacing the linen napkin Claire had given him earlier. "Alice recommended that I have a word with you," he said as I approached.
"Oh?"
My gaze dropped to his jawline. The swelling might have gone down a little, but the bruise was even uglier than when he'd come in.
"Are you feeling all right? Do you need me to do something?"
"No, I'm okay. I wanted to ask you something else entirely. I know you have lots of dogs. I saw them last month when we met at your house."
I nodded. "Yes, we have 6. Sometimes it feels like a lot."
"The thing is, I recently got divorced. That's why I moved to Stamford. I guess you might say I'm starting over."
"I can understand that."
I smiled encouragingly, wishing he'd get to the point. "I didn't realize how lonely it would be, living by myself with no one to talk to. So I decided to fix that."
Evan's expression brightened.
"I went out and bought a puppy. He's a bulldog, 3 months old, and he's great. But the problem is he doesn't know anything."
"Puppies are like that," I said. "They're a blank slate. That's why it's so important to start them right with proper training."
"That's what Alice told me you would say."
Evan paused, then added hopefully,
"She also said you might be willing to help me with that. She said you know everything about dogs."
The thought made me laugh.
"You have that wrong. That's Aunt Peg, not me."
"Your aunt is a formidable woman," Evan replied seriously. "I wouldn't dream of asking her to spend her precious time dealing with my problems."
I was pretty sure there was an implied insult in there about my precious time, but I decided to ignore it. I must have looked annoyed, however, because Evan gestured toward the exit.
"I didn't mean to hold you up. Let me walk you out while we finish our conversation."
We skirted around the last of the stragglers, Aunt Peg's dog show cronies who were still paying court, and let ourselves out the door. In a courtly gesture, Evan took my arm to guide me down the darkened steps.
"I'm the White Prius," he told me.
Last to arrive, he'd still managed to find a spot near the house.
"So what do you think? Bully's awfully cute, but he and I need proper guidance from someone who knows what she's doing. Will you help me get him off to a good start?"
Of course I agreed. Evan shook my hand and thanked me profusely. His gratitude seemed so out of proportion to the favor he'd requested that I wondered if he'd expected me to turn him down. Maybe when I was finished showing him how to train his puppy, I'd work on finding a way to shore up his self-esteem. After we'd made a plan to get together later in the week, Evan got in his car. When he started the engine, his headlights flicked on. They illuminated the Prius's grill and fender. My gaze slid over the front of the car, looking for signs of damage. To my surprise, the white bumper looked pristine. That was odd. Even if Evan hadn't been wearing a seatbelt, it was hard to imagine how he'd ended up with such a big bruise without acquiring so much as a scratch on his car. I would have asked, but Evan was already backing away down the driveway. I stood and watched him leave. Thanks to his new puppy, I'd be seeing him again soon. There'd be plenty of time to find out then. Chapter 3. The drive from Greenwich to my home in North Stamford took only 20 minutes on the Merritt Parkway. Stamford is a thriving city on the Connecticut coast in Lower Fairfield County. Like much of the area, it had once served as a haven for New York commuters. Since that time, however, the city has grown in both size and opportunity.
Stamford now possesses more than enough commerce to be a destination in its own right. I lived with my family well north of downtown on the other side of the Merritt Parkway. Fortunately, our suburban neighborhood remained mostly untouched by the rapid expansion that characterized much of the city. We had wide streets lined by mature trees and houses situated on comfortable two-acre lots. Children can play outside and ride the school bus to local schools. It's a great place to raise a family. I'd barely entered the house when a delighted shriek filled the air. Mommy's home! My younger son, Kevin, 4 years old, and turbo-powered by boundless energy and exuberance, came flying down the hallway. He launched himself into my open arms. Following just behind him were five big, black standard poodles, each hoping to offer a greeting of his or her own. I straightened and swept Kev up in the air as we were mobbed by the oncoming dogs. The poodle scrambled, then ducked and bobbed as I swung my son around in a circle. That led to more shrieking and even a bark or two. My favorite kind of welcome. Standards are the largest of the three poodle varieties. They're smart and athletic, and they know how to tell a joke. When they're happy, which is most of the time, they bounce straight up in the air, springing skyward from all 4 feet at once. Poodles also possess a natural sense of empathy and a strong desire to please. They're a perfect companion for just about any activity, or no activity at all. As the mayhem continued, Faith, dog of my heart and the oldest member of our poodle posse, flattened her ears against her head and gave me a reproachful look. It wasn't that she objected to boisterous play, just that at her advanced age of almost 9, she sometimes felt obliged to stand upon her dignity, and perhaps to try and remind me of mine. Faith was the first pet I'd ever owned. She had come to me as a gift from Aunt Peg when she was just a puppy, and she'd quickly taught me all the pleasures of dog ownership. Over the years we'd spent together, she'd enriched my life in more ways than I could count. So when Faith registered a rebuke, even a mild one, I listened. After the second swoop around, I stopped and set Kevin down on the floor in front of me. He wobbled briefly on his feet, then looked up and cried, "More!" "No, no more," I blew out of breath. That child was getting heavy. "I'm worn out. Look what time it is. I thought you'd be in bed by now." "It's summer vacation," Kevin informed me, as if I didn't know. And let's face it, we were talking about vacation from half days of preschool. "You still need your sleep," I told him. "Nope," Kev shook his head. "I'm not tired." "It's after 9 o'clock. I headed toward the kitchen, the patter of many feet followed behind. "Where's everyone else?" "Outside catching fireflies." Kevin slithered around me and ran on ahead. As I turned the corner, I saw the back door leading out to the deck was wide open. The light in the kitchen was serving as a calling card to every bug in the neighborhood. I flicked off the switch, and the poodles and I followed Kevin out into the fenced backyard. It was a beautiful midsummer night. Though still warm, the air was clear and fresh. Looking up, I felt like I could see 1,000 stars in the wide sky. Then my gaze returned to Earth, and I saw my own personal star heading toward me across the darkened yard. Sam isn't just my partner. He's my best friend. We've been married for 6 years. He and I support each other, and we complement each other's flaws. We always seem to be able to find something to laugh about, and I never get tired of looking at his smile. When Sam stopped in front of me and pulled me into his arms for a hug, I leaned into the embrace and sighed. It was good to be home. "How was book club?" he asked. "Interesting." I dropped my arms and stepped away.
"Oh? Not all book chat and pupcakes?"
"Hardly," I laughed. "The meeting did take place at Aunt Peg's house, after all." Abruptly, all five standard poodles went flying past us. Somewhere in the back of the yard, a rabbit must have poked its head out of a hole. I doubted that the dogs would catch it, but they would certainly enjoy the chase. Tar, an impressive adult male and Sam's former specials dog, was leading the charge. Augie, Davy's poodle, who'd recently completed his championship, raced alongside him. Two bitches, Faith's daughter Eve and Sam's Raven, scrambled to keep up. Faith trotted along sedately in the rear. It was the first time in several years that we didn't have a dog in hair. With no show coat to protect, we didn't have to monitor the poodle's play. Bud could jump up and yank on Augie's ear, and the only one who would yell at him for that was Augie. It was nice to be off duty for a change. Kev said something about fireflies, I said. Where's Davy? Sam pointed toward the big oak tree in the middle of the yard. He's up in the treehouse. Hearing his name, my older son leaned out a window. I could barely see him through the leafy branches. Hey, Mom, he called. Look what we have. Davy held out a mason jar that appeared to be lit from within. When I walked closer, the soft glow inside the wide glass bottle separated into a dozen twinkling lights. I hope you poked holes in the top, I said. Of course. Davy sounded miffed. He was 13 and ready to start high school in the fall. As a consequence, he knew everything. Besides, we're letting them go at the end of the night anyway. That's right, Kevin agreed with a solemn nod. I wanted to put them in my room, but Dad said it would be mean to keep them just because they look nice. His voice dropped to a horrified whisper. They could die. I crouched down in front of him. That's nice of you to want the fireflies to live a long, happy life, even though that means you can't enjoy them in the house. How come you were inside when everyone else was out here? I was looking for Bud, Kev told me. He disappeared. I glanced up at Sam, who said, Bud was out here with us earlier, but he seems to have gone missing. Now that they mentioned it, I realized that I hadn't seen the little spotted dog since I'd arrived home. Usually he hung out with the other dogs. Gates both closed? I asked. Yup, Sam replied. I checked. He hasn't been digging any new holes, has he? Not that I'm aware of. My guess is that he found some kind of treasure out here and dragged it inside to hide behind the couch. For Bud, a treasure could mean anything from one of Davy's smelly gym socks to a medium-sized Halloween pumpkin. The chubby little mutt was a pack rat. His obsession with gathering portable objects and storing them in his self-styled den verged on hoarding. Bud had been with us for a year now. All we knew about his past situation was that it had been bad. When we picked him up from the side of the road the previous summer, the little dog had been skinny, wormy, and covered with sores. That was long behind him now, but Bud still wolfed down his food like he was afraid it might disappear, and his obedience training continued to be a work in progress. I'll track down Bud if you put Kev to bed, I told Sam. My younger son's eyes were already drooping. I was pretty sure he'd be asleep in minutes. Unless it turns out that whatever Bud brought in the house was once alive and is now dead. In that case, I reserve the right to switch jobs. Sam grinned. I figured that meant we had a deal. He picked up Kevin. I called the poodles. Davy came swinging down from the treehouse. We all watched as he opened the jar and released the fireflies back into the night. Pretty, Kevin said drowsily. He lifted a hand and waved goodbye. Sam and Kevin went upstairs. Davy washed and dried the mason jar and put it away, all without being asked. That was kind of miraculous. Then he spent the rest of the evening in a more predictable teenage fashion, locked in his room, talking to his friends on the phone. I found Bud behind the couch in the living room, gnawing happily on a stick. You could have done that outside, I told him as I pried the prize out of his mouth. Bud wagged his stubby tail. The black patch over his eye gave him a piratical air. It's more fun this way. Faith looked at the spotted dog and rolled her eyes. She'd probably told him much the same thing I had. Wood chips were scattered everywhere. I swept them into a dustpan, deposited them in the garbage can, and counted myself lucky. At least Bud hadn't brought in something really gross. Half an hour later, Sam and I met up in the living room. We sat down on the couch and put our feet up on the coffee table. Bud was upstairs, asleep on Kevin's bed. Four of the poodles draped themselves over the furniture around us. Faith was wedged in beside me on the couch. That's about as cozy as it gets around here. Sam turned on a TV show that was lacking in logical plot, but featured plenty of honking horns and screeching tires. As far as I could tell, the program had been created for the sole purpose of serving as background noise. So I proceeded to tell him about the book club meeting. Sam enjoyed a good book as much as the next person, but the idea of having to discuss what he'd read reminded him entirely too much of school. He'd declined to join the club, but was happy to hear about what was going on with the people who had. This time, there were twice as many people to tell him about. I thought Sam would be surprised to hear that. He wasn't. I sat up straight and stared at him. Faith lifted her head inquiringly. She thought we were settled in for the night. I massaged her withers with my fingertips and she lay back down. "You knew?" I said to Sam. He just shrugged. "Peg and I talk?" "Aunt Peg and I talk too, but she hadn't mentioned anything to me about doubling the membership of my book club." Visions of a hostile takeover flitted through my brain. Then I got real. This was a neighborhood reading group we were talking about, not Warner Media.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.